So I am the director of programs at Openhouse, and Openhouse serves LGBT seniors in San Francisco Bay Area through building housing, services, and community welcoming to LGBT seniors 55 plus. We offer this through a variety of ways. We were founded in 1998, primarily to build housing welcoming for LGBT seniors, but we have since expanded to offer case management, information and assistance, and hundreds of hours of socialization activities to reduce isolation for LGBT seniors. We also contract with the City and County of San Francisco to offer cultural competency training, and I've been doing these trainings for the past 7 years in the city. And our training curriculum is nationally recognized, and we are part of the National Resource Center on LGBT Aging, which does these trainings throughout the country with service providers so they could be more affirming and inclusive of LGBT older adults in their community. As I mentioned, Open House is building housing at 55 Laguna, 110 units of affordable senior housing welcoming to the LGBT community, just there at Laguna and Market. We'll have our headquarters move over there, as well as a large activity space with tons of activities offered to the residents of the community, as well as the community of LGBT seniors at large. I want to briefly mention that we offer those hundreds of hours of community activities to help folks reduce their isolation, connect with other LGBT seniors and allies. Three support groups I really want to highlight that are relevant to the topic we're addressing today are the LGBT Dementia Caregiver Support Group, partnering with Alzheimer's Association to offer that once a month, a really amazing group of folks. We offer a grief support group as well as a caregiver self-care support group. I won't go into too much about all the activities that we have, but you can check out our table outside and speak with one of our wonderful staff who are here today. We have Greg Bowden, our emotional and practical support specialist in the back there. Greg, wave. So people can come talk to Greg. And then we have Katie Outson, who's our case manager, who's over there. So come talk to any of us about all of the wonderful things we do at Open House. Okay. So let's face it. Dementia is a subject no one wants to think about, much less talk about. In mainstream LGBT communities, ageism is both overt and internalized. There's the earnest young gay man who runs up to the Open House booth saying, "Gay and senior? Two things I never thought about together before." As well as people who jokingly dismiss the realities of aging, exclaiming, "Haven't you heard? 60 is the new 40. Our denial of aging as a community prevents us from having a real dialogue about aging and the challenges that may come along with it. So how can we, as members of fiercely independent and engaged LGBT communities and allies, begin an open and meaningful conversation about aging that includes both our strengths, both our strengths and our fears? Alzheimer's may be a disease and not a normal part of aging. However, it is a challenging reality many of us are already dealing with or may be impacted by in the future. As uncomfortable as it may be, we can't talk about dementia and Alzheimer's without talking about aging. It's time for our communities to get real about aging, especially while we still have the capacity to prepare for our care. Okay, so presently 20,000 LGBT seniors age 60 and older live in San Francisco. The San Francisco Strategy for Excellence in Dementia Care and Alzheimer's Dementia Expert Panel projected that the total population of older adults living in the city with Alzheimer's will almost be 27,000 in 2020. Using the city's 12% estimate of the LGBT senior population, that will be approximately 3,200 LGBT older adults living with Alzheimer's, which is actually a conservative estimate related to in relation to the total number of LGBT seniors living with all forms of dementia. So in this context, what can we expect as LGBT communities and allies? In 2012, the San Francisco LGBT Aging Policy Task Force worked with Dr. Fredrickson Goldson to publish a report on LGBT seniors age 60 plus in the city, called LGBT Aging at the Golden Gate. The goal of the report was to uncover the needs and concerns of LGBT seniors in the city and to advise the Board of Supervisors on policy recommendations to improve the health and well-being of our community. The task force made two tangible recommendations to address the issues of access to information about and services for LGBT, for Alzheimer's and dementia care. The first, to create an LGBT-targeted education campaign and awareness campaign, and the second, to increase availability of related support groups. I would like to briefly highlight the unique challenges of LGBT older adults of color, bisexual, and transgender older adults. I also want to examine some of the ways we, as service providers, may unintentionally further isolate LGBT seniors in our practice. And lastly, I want to offer a real snapshot of situations we might encounter when working with LGBT older adults. So research has underscored the challenges facing LGBT seniors in social services and healthcare settings. We know LGBT seniors have lived through a lifetime of stigma and discrimination based on their sexual orientation and gender identity. So it's not surprising that they are 5 times less likely to access health and social services when compared to their heterosexual counterparts. The task force survey I mentioned earlier found that LGBT older adults often experience the compounding effects of discrimination based on sexual orientation, gender identity, age, race. Although there was a low turnout among the API, the Asian Pacific Islander, and Russian communities, LGBT people of color who participated in the task force survey reported higher service needs, including lower rates of identity disclosure, less legal planning for the future, higher rates of discrimination and abuse, and higher rates of HIV/AIDS. Underlying the complexity of issues that LGBT seniors face is that they are much more likely to be childless, single, and living alone compared to their straight counterparts, and therefore often lack the informal caregiver support typically provided by adult children, spouses, or family members. If strong social connections are the number one predictor of positive mental health across the lifetime, without these family support systems, LGBT seniors are at a higher risk for social isolation, directly impacting their ability to age in community. The good news is that LGBT seniors have forged strong support networks comprised of families of choice. LGBT communities are no strangers to caregiving, having had a long history of providing care, most powerfully demonstrated during the height of the HIV/AIDS epidemic. Today, LGBT communities are caring for both families of origin and families of choice. In a study by the National Gay and Lesbian Task Force, 2/3 of LGBT caregiver respondents were the primary caregivers for members of their family of origin, 35% of whom were caring for them due to Alzheimer's disease or dementia. For caregivers providing care for family members of choice, 41% needed to provide care due to HIV and AIDS. Over the last 7 years I've been offering training on LGBT cultural competency, I've had people speak up during presentations to say it's actually not all true that most LGBT seniors are childless, single, and living alone. People of color are more likely to have children. This made me curious, and as I began to investigate, I found recent data revealing a different picture of LGBT families that typically are examined on the discourse of LGBT aging. A recent study showed that both Black and Latino same-sex couples are more likely to raise children than white same-sex couples. Nearly 1/3 of binational same-sex couples are raising a total of 17,000 children. LGBT families are more racially and ethnically diverse than families headed by married heterosexual couples, with 41% same-sex couples with children identifying as people of color, compared to 34% of married different sex couples with children. We may anticipate a changing landscape in terms of future caregiving generations with more LGBT people having children. This is a current strength in our communities that hasn't had much recognition. LGBT communities of color have been underrepresented in studies of this kind, and I hope more research will be done in this area. Additionally, a MetLife study on LGBT boomers revealed the experiences of bisexuals as significantly different from those of lesbians, gay men, and transgender people. They have considerably fewer friends and have by far the lowest rates of being out and finding acceptance. Twice as guarded with other people as any other LGBT subpopulation, and are far less to say that being LGBT was an important part of their identity. In terms of transgender older adults, it's not an exaggeration to consider the challenges facing older transgender adults as a crisis. Transgender seniors nearly always reported higher risks, including lower incomes, higher service needs, lower housing stability, victimization, and discrimination. They also more frequently reported poor health and mental health and much higher rates of suicidal ideation. So now let's consider how we as providers may be contributing to these challenges. Assumption one, service providers assume that we can identify LGBT seniors who are accessing our services. We assume that people who come into our organization are heterosexual because they just don't, quote, look gay, right? These are lovely open house community members on this slide. The heterosexist practice further isolates LGBT seniors because if LGBT people cannot be identified by their appearance, even those of us ourselves who are LGBT might make the assumption that folks who are coming in for our services are straight. Well, it's actually the opposite at Open House. We assume that everybody is LGBT, but that's beside the point. That's a different situation. So assumption two. Healthcare and social services providers believe that if we don't ask about sexual orientation or gender identity, that our organization is not discriminating against LGBT people. The reality is that older adults don't use our services because there is no LGBT-specific targeted outreach or programming. When they do come in, they might retreat to the closet for safety. They may not talk about their lives openly for fear of being treated badly. And we've heard this before. Silence means invisibility, and invisibility for our LGBT seniors reinforces isolation. Ultimately, if we are not asking about sexual orientation or gender identity as part of our data collection process, the result is that LGBT seniors don't feel safe. As LGBT individuals, we are hypervigilant about scanning for clues for safety. Safety is the number one concern for LGBT seniors and for seniors in the general population for that matter. However, there are specific signifiers we must proactively communicate in our agencies to reach LGBT seniors with the message that we understand the importance of what it means to feel safe. Speakers today will be going into greater detail about affirming and inclusive best practices. Last assumption, because our culture tends to desexualize all older adults and over-sexualize LGBT people, providers may think, well, why does it matter if a person is LGBT or not, an older adult is LGBT? This is where ageism and homophobia collide. The thought is, seniors aren't sexual, but by definition, LGBT people are essentialized as such. Accordingly, a senior can't be both a senior and also be LGBT. Being LGBT is about identity as much as it is about sexuality. If seniors can't identify themselves, then how can they receive quality care and services? Being known is critical to receiving quality, client-centered care when working with older adults and LGBT older adults. The best care is always tailored care. So where do we go from here? How much time do I have? Time now? What? How did that happen? Okay, I just want to just mention one last thing. What do we go from here? LGBT aging-specific training matters. These trainings increase the comfort level and confidence of providers in asking sexual orientation and gender identity questions. Open House provides these trainings in San Francisco and across the state, and we have very interactive case scenarios that involve the complexity of identities and needs facing LGBT older adults. And I had a number of scenarios that I think I might save for our panel discussion later on. But I would like to close with a call to action, a simple call to action. Consider how we might do things differently if we didn't assume the sexual orientation or gender identity of an older adult seeking our services until they reveal it to us. All right. Thank you.